Middle Path Radio, illuminating the horizon.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه ومن اهتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. I hope you brothers are well, and I hope you know everyone who's watching at home as well as well. Alhamdulillah. Today was a very special day. We had a very special evening with Ustaz Ashiq al-Rahman, who's a graduate of Azhar University. He studied Islamic law and Arabic. He's also a teacher of Quran. And today's session in and of itself was about the Quran. It was about the ultimate miracle. And Ustaz, elucidated and gave many points about the Quran, its role, the importance of the Quran, how to approach the Quran, given that Ramadan is coming up. And that's, as you guys know, it's a theme that we've, really been, honing in on, focusing on over the last, few weeks. So, having said all of this, we have with us, alhamdulillah, who says your name?
Yeomin.
Tanbih.
Tanbih. I'm Naseem, whoever says.
My name is Qadhi Ashiq al-Rahman.
Ashiq al-Rahman. Yep.
Brother Abdus-Samad.
Abdus-Samad.
Abdullah Hussein.
So this is like, as you guys will be aware, it's like a reflective session where we focus on some of the things that we learned from the dars, some of the benefits that we gained, and things that we acquired. So we're gonna start off from the right, inshallah. Akhi, can you mention one or two points, Tanweed, or one or two things that struck you that you benefited from, in terms of the talk and what the Ustaz said?
Assalamu alaikum. The Sheikh said something about reading Quran, like a good way to memorize it, before you go to sleep, just put you on a nice one, nice recitation. And then when you wake up, you should you'll be able to have read it and memorized it better than if you didn't have to go to sleep. And that, to me, that's quite good because I'm memorizing Quran myself.
Jazakallah khairan. I think that's a very useful tip. As in, so sometimes there's a difference between active effort and passive effort. So the Quran can be learned, using both. As in, we can really utilize, our cognitive abilities to learn the Quran actively by reciting and so on and so forth. And Ustad, I think, mentioned a point about, just listen to the Quran, on the go, whenever we're on the train or wherever if we're in different places. We can have the Quran around us, so we're learning it passively. Instead, I think, mentioned a point where the Salaf or the pious predecessors used to always, rotate their lives around the Quran, so much so, he also mentioned a contemporary scholar who, if he wasn't doing anything, he was, focusing on the Quran. So, do you remember this person's name? Or if you don't remember this person's name, can you mention some scholars or some teachers of Quran or some reciters that you really like? And you can, you can tell our viewers about. Or anything that, you benefit from of the talk. You can be very open.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام وآله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته to those who are listening. So about the Quran. So the Quran, it cures everything in your heart. Sad mentioning between Quran and books. It's like, why are you reading the Quran when you're meant to be reading books, meaning revision for your exam? And I was like, the Quran really massages your mind. It gives your memory and strength. And you know what? It lowers your anger. It removes anger off.
JazakAllah khair. Brother Yaman, mashaAllah. Yani he always gives you know some points that no one really thinks about. And some of the words that sometimes he drops, mashaAllah, really mind blowing. Massages the Quran. It really is like that, in the sense that it gives that comfort. Yeah. It gives that comfort to the mind, to the heart, to everything. And these are really nice words. And we ask Allah, you know, to increase us in confidence. So moving, we're gonna, you know, go this way. We're gonna, you know, come to Ustaz, and then we're gonna go to these brothers. We want to move on to the crux of our topics, the main thing that we want to discuss. Ustaz, we've talked about the Quran, yep, its importance.
Yep.
What about memorizing the Quran? You know, it's a big thing. As someone who's, you know, been there, done it, you know, would you say, can you take us through its importance, the memorization of the Quran, okay, and how to approach it practically?
Okay. Bismillah, salatu wassalamu ala rasulillah. And I think we touched upon the topic of memorization, some tips within the talk itself. But subhanallah, I mean, Quran, to memorize it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it easy for it to be memorized. And for that reason, we have thousands and hundreds of thousands of huffaz around the world who don't even understand a single word of the Quran. So it's possible to memorize the Quran without even understanding it. That's point number one. Point number two is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those who make an intention, فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that when you have made a decision to do something, rest of it, tawakkal ala Allah, rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So say for example, I want to do the good deed of memorizing the Quran, okay? First of all, I know, I should tell myself, and this is very psychological as well, when I think something is hard, it seems hard. Mm-hmm. Right? When I build that barrier for myself that it's hard, then it's going to remain hard. Mm-hmm. So tell yourself that it's easy because Allah said it's easy. Allah has made it easy for you to memorize. And the evidence is there. People who haven't spoken a single word of Arabic. Look, for example, at Bangladesh or Somalia or Pakistan or India. People don't even speak, you know, they don't even say hello in Arabic or how are you. But they will recite the whole Quran to you without even a single mistake. And they will go to international competitions and they will pass and they will come first and second and third. SubhanAllah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is very, very, of course, you know, it's true that Allah has made it easy. Number two, so psychologically address and accept that it's easy. Secondly, it's about making a firm decision. So first we said address that is easy, and secondly, make a firm decision. Meaning, I want to do it, so I will do it. Okay, be people of principle. Be people of that I want to do something, so I'm going to see if it's possible. And realize that you as a human, as a person, if you really want to do something, you tell me, if you really want to do something, is there anything that can stop you? If you want to really have two hot wings and chips, if you really want to have two hot wings and chips from Spice Up, KHF. Is anything KHF?
Shout out KHF.
Well, actually, do you know what? Anyone that's, you know, any, you know, restaurant that's HMC, mashallah, yeah? But like, definitely halal, yeah? If you really want to have a halal donor, okay, is anything going to stop you? You will find the money from somewhere and you will get the bus. And even if it's 12 o'clock in the night from East Ham, you will get the 25 and you come to Mile End. And people do that, and I do that sometimes as well. Yeah. So when you really want to do something, trust me, don't go because you should be sleeping at the time. But if you do go in Ramadan around about one or 2 o'clock, you'll find people having full whack meals like they just woke up. They're still wearing their football costumes and whatnot. SubhanAllah. If you really want to do something, you can do it. Okay. If you really want, where there is a will, there is a way. Where there is a will, there is a way. And we know in the past people have attempted flying. Okay, and they fell and they died. In fact, one of the great people of Lugha as well, was Al Mubarrid, I think. Mubarrid, one of the Lughawis, he wanted to fly. So he attempted flying. He made some wings and he jumped from a building and he died. So, meaning, people have tried and they eventually were successful. Whatever you want to do, my friends, okay, inshallah, if you keep on trying, you'll be able to do it. Now, so you've addressed that it's easy. Mm-hmm. Secondly, you've addressed that you can do it.
Allah said so.
Allah said so. Allah, okay, said so. And you need to agree and accept that, and look at the evidence around you. If my brother, from my young brother, 6-year-old, 7-year-old, 8-year-old, who doesn't understand a word of Arabic, can memorize it, why can't I, who has had much more training in terms of learning and memorizing and educating, why can't I do it? What's the difference? There is no difference. You have the same heart, the same brain, same mind. Okay, so you've got the determination. Now, next, to make a plan. Make a plan, especially as people, students of other ulum, like if you go to uni, if you go to college, if you go to work, if you have family, if you've got kids, if you got, you know, if you got to go drive Uber, for example, yeah? I'm just giving an example, right? If you're a bus driver, if you're anything, if you're an engineer, right? Everyone's got things to do.
And the Sahaba had things to do. But this is one thing we forget, that the Sahaba were all part-time students. Right, except for some. But most of the Sahaba were part-time students, were they not? They all had their own work to do. Abdurrahman Ma'af was a merchant. Abu Bakr was a merchant. Okay, we had other people that were, you know, specialists in jihad. Khalid Mawlid was out there. You got other people that were specialists in zira'ah. Okay, and they used to do tanawub. They used to say, you listen for me, and when we come back from work, we listen from you. And tomorrow, I'll go to the dars, you'll go to work, and I will listen from you. Meaning, they were all part-time students. Meaning, all of us, even though if you're doing something else, we can still work around it. Exactly. Okay? Yeah, you can plan your time. Mm-hmm. You can plan your time, definitely. Don't tell me that you're gonna work for 24 hours. It's not true. Okay? Unless you really are, and you can't, then obviously for you, it's a different case. But if you are someone that wants to do it, then plan it around your day. Plan it around the things you do. One thing, remember though, when you're planning, do not make it boring. I'm telling you, you're not going to last. Do not make it entertaining. Make it fun. Beneficial. Make it things that you can actually, make it possible. You know, some people give themselves a massive target. I'm going to recite the whole Quran in 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. Mashallah, if you can, go for it. But when you put that much pressure on yourself, you will crack. I know, and I'm not going to say names, but a lot of brothers, they go to Egypt to study. And I say to them, Akhi, mashallah, you're here to study. Let me introduce you to some brothers, okay? So you can play football with them every on the weekends. They were like, nah, I'm here, I'm gonna study. Man, I'm not gonna call my family. Do you get it? So they're really serious. 2-3 weeks later, they're like, Akhi, how do you change your ticket? Where's the Egypt ticket place? Do you get it? It happens. So people, you can't put so much pressure on yourself, okay? Islam is easy, okay? The deen is easy. Keep it easy, especially when it comes to something that memorizing the Quran. It's not fard upon everyone, okay? You don't have to do it. But if you want to do it, then Allah will reward you for it. And of course, the benefits of becoming a hafiz are numerous, okay? Numerous. The amount of respect you get, iqra' wartaqi. Recite every ayah and you go to the next level of Jannah. Allahu Akbar. What's more special than that? You know, it's like someone saying to me, like, you know, go to a 5-star hotel, right? And there's different levels. There's a normal room, and then you have the double room, then you have the executive room, then you have the suite, then you have the penthouse, right? Then you have these different levels. And imagine someone said to me, all you have to do to climb higher to the next better room, just read one ayah. That's a good deal, right? If someone's, you go on Emirates now, and you go on economy seat, someone says, the steward says, you know what, recite one ayah from Quran, I'll put in business class. How would you feel? If someone, you're in business class, someone says, you know what? Read one ayah, I'll put in first class. You'll have your own bed, your own shower, and we'll give you a menu to choose from, food. How would that feel? Amazing, right? Jannah, we can't even imagine how beautiful it is. Okay, ma la ayn ra'at, wa la udhun sami'at, wa la khatar ala qalbi bashar. No eye has seen, no ear has ever heard, no person has ever thought of it. Okay, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you with Jannah at whichever level, depending on your ability, you go to. The other thing about becoming a hafiz, your parents are honored. They wear that crown that outshines the sun. You have the ability to do shifa'ah of people. Okay? You can ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to put certain people in Jannah because of your honor that you have. When someone is special to the president, to the prime minister, okay, or to the king, I'll ask him, like, yo, you know what? You're close to him, innit? He's your boy, innit? Tell him to hook it up, innit? Like that. So Allah loves you when you become a hafiz. So you making a request to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He will accept that request because it's special to Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very clearly, Ahlul Qur'an, Ahlullahi wa khasatu. The people of the Qur'an are the people, the special people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who doesn't want to be special to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Imagine this. You went to a bank to open your account to receive your uni loan, for example, yeah? Okay, and it's a massive queue, 30 mans in front of you. Okay, or any other example, went to the post office, right? And there's about 30, 40 people in front of you. Well, you went to Spice Out, and there's about 50 people in front of you. It's not gonna happen because you're gonna be outside the shop then. Realistically, what I'm trying to say, imagine you're at the back of a queue, but then the manager or the boss man comes and he says, yo, Naseem, hey, yeah, I know you. Come, let's go right to the front. I'll do your thing for you. How would you feel? You'd feel so happy, right? Imagine you're sitting in the middle of Islamic Masjid, right? And Imam Abdul Qayyum or Sheikh, Abu al-Husayn, he says, hey, Yamin. Samad, hey, I know you, come here, you sit right next to me. How would you feel? You'd feel so special, right? So imagine on the day of Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will look out for the people of the Quran. These are the special people of the Quran. And He will say, you know what, you guys, there's no calculation for you, you're going straight to Jannah. And you recite each ayah and you go to the next level. How would you feel then? You can't even imagine how you'd feel. Does that make sense? So, memorization of the Quran is something beautiful. There is no doubt about how special it is. There is no doubt about how much honor it brings you in this dunya and in akhirah. Does a hafiz get respect?
Yes. Yes.
Does he make peace?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does. Okay. So he gets respect. He makes money. Okay. Some people think that if you become hafiz of Quran, then you know what you're going to do. If you become a scholar, then you know what you're going to eat. You know what you're going to eat. So I'll give you an example. This one lady said, I don't want to educate my son in madrasa because then he can't eat rice. And so one scholar said, well, of course he's not going to eat rice. He's going to be too busy eating biryani. He's going to be going dawats because people are going to be inviting him and respecting him, honoring him. Does that make sense? Yeah. So make a firm decision. Know that it's easy. Make a firm decision. Make a plan that's suitable for you. One page a day, half a page a day. And be consistent. Well, I was just talking to some brothers. Consistency doesn't mean that if you miss one day, it's the end of the world. Consistency, okay, means that you're a human. You can make mistakes. Even the Prophet ﷺ, he missed Fajr one day, right? It happens to even the Anbiya alayhim salatu wasalam. It happens to the Sahaba. So mistakes are allowed. If you miss a day, it's okay. Carry on from the following day. Don't let shaitan tell you, yo, you flopped, man. What's the point? You can't even do it anymore. You're a waste, man. Don't let that thought come into your mind. Do you understand? It's okay. You're allowed to make mistakes. Okay, just carry on. Consistency with mistakes is okay. Okay, so you make a plan, half a page, three quarters of a page, okay? Even if it's a little bit, you'll find with time, okay, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet said in the hadith that the most beloved of actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that good deed which, even though it's less, is continuous. Mm-hmm. And continuous, like I said now, doesn't mean if you don't do it one day, it's the end of the world. It's not the end of the world. So, make a plan, stick to it, be consistent, okay? Don't let shaitan tell you that if you miss one day, it's the end of the world. Carry on, pick yourself up again, okay? And last but not least, realize. Remember in your mind why you're doing it. Have the goal in front of you. Okay, have the goal in front of you. You know where you're going. When you're going to uni, when you feel like, oh, I can't bother to do this anymore, you remind yourself like, hey, if I do this, then X, Y, Z, I'll have a good job. I'll be driving that BMW. I'll be having that house. You know, so you need to encourage yourself. So have the end goal in front of you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love me, honor me, will give me rizq, will do everything for me. And he will take that responsibility on his. So these are some of the tips, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala. And every single person is different. Okay, your memory, if my friend can memorize two pages a day and I can't do it, there is no reason for you to feel bad. Okay, if you can do two lines, that's fine, alhamdulillah. Allah has given me that ability and I will deal with that and I will increase on that. I would put effort into that. And slowly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the doors for you, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala. Jazakallah khairan.
Barakallah feek. So I suppose the main thing is, there's a saying in Arabic, "Al-fashlu fi al-taqtiti huwa al-taqtit lil-fashli." And we mentioned this, like failing to plan is planning to fail. So, like in this sense, I think Ustad really, you know, took us through, you know, someone's journey, like a potential journey. So if a person, you know, really plans, has the right intention, goes about doing the right things, then they can really, you know, achieve their goals, you know, these goals and these aims and these, you know, big visions, and so that Allah will honor them on the Day of Judgment. Having said this, Ustad, maybe we might just come back to you after.
Inshallah,
no problem. We want to move to Brother Abdul Samad. I think Ustad touched on, you know, the virtues of Ahlul Quran, but we want to, you know, return our sight back to, you know, the talk and what we talked about. So I'm just going to ask you something, you know, for the benefit of our viewers. How or what do you remember? What do you remember from Ustad's talk about how the Quran stumped the Arabs, left the Arabs stumped, as in how it just like ajazahum, like just left them for dead in the sense. So what do you remember?
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Amma ba'd, rabbi isli sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul min lisani. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. What I remember is from Ustad's talk is that the Arabs were so shocked by the Quran because there were great poets at that time. For example, Amr, may Allah be pleased with him. His family came from noble poets. They were good at poetry. And they were great linguists. And the Quran is stand the test of time. For example, if you come to the non-Muslims, they will say, well, you guys believe in the Quran. It says, oh, Moses split the sea. Wow, well, I don't have a time machine. It'll take me back to time, back 3,000 years ago. That's not tangible. The Quran is tangible now. It stands from the test of time, from to here to the Day of Judgment. Allah says in the Surah Kaf, in the first ayah, this book has no crookedness and has no errors and no mistakes and it has no contradictions. Allah even tests the kuffar saying that bring an ayah like it, bring like two free eyes. The shores surah is surah Kawthar, which are free eyes, isn't it?
Mm.
And even bring even a chapter like it. People have failed to do that. Many people make such claims, like the poets at that time, they were shocked, they were confused. How could this man bring something like this? It's a product, it's a genius. He doesn't know how to read, he doesn't know how to write. He comes from a poor family background. His families are nobles, like in terms of like the way they present themselves. He's an honest man, he was known as Al-Amin, the honest one. So how could this be the case, that this Quran, it lasts till for 1,400 years, till now, no one has even managed to come up with something like this. It has scientific evidence. Like, for example, it talks about the embryology. It talks about things that Allah says that in Surah Al-Anbiya, that every living thing is made out of water. It talks about things about the creation of the universe, the Big Bang, which we came to know today. It talks about وَغُلْبَ الْرُومِ, that the Persians will be defeated. And the Muslims at the time of the Battle of Brother, the Prophet, they'll look at the Prophet, what do you mean? The Romans will be defeated. And then the scholars at that time, they have their own tafsir. They're saying what that could have meant is that they won the Battle of Badr, and so did their kind of close allies, the Christian Romans, against the Persians. But then Allah says, but wait, the Persians will be come back 3 to 9 years, and that's exact that time span. That's exactly what happened. These are historical evidence that we come to know. Like, for example, it talks about the story of Isa bin Maryam. Like, and there are new studies about. Wait, there are certain stories in the gospel that weren't revealed, but how come the Quran mentions it? Like, we have new gospels, the gospel of like Saint Thomas or whoever, yeah? Or that Isa spoke from the cradle. And they found in this old gospel, that they found like 100 years ago. The Quran speaks about so many things, like intricate details. And yet, what do? We leave it around. In a Bengali culture, do you know what we do? We tie around the knot. We leave it up to the You don't know the meanings of it. My brothers, many of us don't know how to recite the Surah Fatiha. We don't even know the meaning of it. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. All praise due to Allah, the Lord of all the worlds. We don't know even that. We don't know Bismillah Rahman Rahim, in the name of Allah, the most merciful and especially merciful. Like things that the poets at that time, they couldn't understand what is this guy saying. And then they had to come to ponder and realization, wait, he must be speaking the haqq. He must be speaking the truth. If he's not speaking the truth, then he can't be a sire. Because look what happened. He says that this is not magic. This is nothing like this. He's not a sorcerer. And the Arabs were shocked. They couldn't believe it. That's why many of them, they became Muslim. They became from the worst of people to the best of people. That's why no one can test the Quran. Allah has promised. Allah makes a promise. And Allah never goes back on his promise. This is a sunnah of Allah. Allah says that I will guard the Quran, I will guard this kitab. Allah says, وَأَتَسِيمُ بِهَبْ لَيْهِ جَمِيعُ وَتَفَرَّكُ. Hold on to the rope of Allah and do not be divided or misguided. And what is it referring to? Many of the Salafs of the Ummah, they said that this is referring to the Tabi'in. They said this is referring to the Quran. Even though the Prophet ﷺ said this is referring to the Quran. Stick to the Quran. And people say, well, how do you act upon the Quran? وَأَتِيُ اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُ رَسُولُ. Obey Allah and obey His Messenger. Look towards the messenger. Be like the messenger. Didn't the messenger come with beneficial knowledge? Wadini haq. And the knowledge come with beneficial knowledge and with truth. And so that we can implement it in our lives. So it's a sunnah. That's what stand up to me today, because there are things I didn't know, and I'm sure that many of you guys didn't know. And we're learning today, we're all students. So pick up the Quran, read it, and do your best. Like Umar ibn al-Khattab once said that in his time, in his khilafah, he said that, don't look at the one who's reciting so beautifully and doesn't act upon it. Look at the one, yes, he struggles, but he does his best to act upon it. That's the one I will always be on the side with. Subhanallah. And we should, doesn't matter if you stutter a bit, like so I used to have stuttering problem. That's why you recite, like you read the dua of Musa alayhi salam, Rabbi Islam, sorry, wahlu. Recite that dua is to open up your chest and so that people and untie the knot in your tongue so people can understand it and even Allah can understand what you're saying. Allah will accept it. Do not think that the mercy of Allah, the rahmah of Allah is far away from you. Is right there. What you need to do is pick up the Quran. Do not abandon the Quran. Drop everything, go to your salah. After your salah, go to the Quran. Recite it. Understand it, try and memorize it, learn it, act upon it, and invite all those to the truth, and invite people to the truth, and tell the people of disbelief that this is the haq, this is what we believe, we are Muslims. And inshallah, Allah will guide us. Ameen.
Ameen, ya Rabbi. Ameen, ya Rabbi. Mashallah.
Barakallah feek. May Allah, you're an orator, mashallah. May Allah accept, you know, these everything from us. We ask Allah to allow us to understand, you know, all of these things, and understand the dars in and of itself, understand the concept, understand the issue at hand, and really try and, you know, implement it. And finally, akhi, your name?
Abdullah.
Okay. Abdullah Hussein. One final question here. So we're going to go to you, and then we're just going to, you know, conclude with the Ustad. So any final remarks, if he's got any. What does it mean to you when I say, I want to make the Quran my best friend? So what does it mean to you? So we've discussed, so we discussed many things with Abdul Samad. We had a lot from Yawmin, we had a lot from Tanweed. So what does it mean for you, briefly, what does the making the Quran your best friend mean for you? And then we'll conclude with this step.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Rabbi shrahli sadri wa yassir li amri wa ahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. The brothers here, they mentioned a lot of the miracles of the Quran, and unfortunately we cannot do it justice in this panel, but I would like to address the question, what does it mean to make the Quran your best friend? So as Muslims, we do not just recite the Quran, we just do not look at the meaning and the tafsir and take it and leave it. We must act upon it, we must embody it in our actions, in our the way we treat people and the way we go about things. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that sorry, I lost my chain of thought. Okay, I'll come back to that, but yeah, we should ponder over the Quran. And even the most academic of people, the most intelligent people, they could not fathom like the things that would come up in the Quran. This was the 7th century Arabia, and now we are in the 21st century. And Brother Abdul Samad has mentioned the scientific importance that and the historical importance that the Quran goes through in such intricate detail. But what we must do as Muslims is ponder over the Quran. We must read it like we enjoy it, as Ustad has said and mentioned. And it should not become a chore for us. We should love the Quran with all our heart. And we should remember that Allah does not need us, and we need Allah. So we should reflect on the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And inshallah, He will make everything for us easy, as He is omniscient and omnipotent.
Jazakallah khairan, jazakumullah khairan to all of you brothers for all of your wonderful comments. There's a lot to take in, there's a lot to digest. Ustad, we'll conclude with you. First, I want to ask you if there's three key words where people, you know, like we like things to be easy for us.
Simplified.
If there are three key words that you can give us that really, you know, sort of summarize, you know, everything that we've discussed, you know, in the talk and now, and perhaps maybe if you can add on some, you know, final remarks, and we'll conclude there. Jazakallah khair.
SubhanAllah, it's a bit of a hard task to come up with three words to summarize the whole thing, but I think those three words would have to be, first of all, love, learn, and live. So love the Quran, love the deen, learn it, next step, and then don't just leave it as knowledge in your head, live it. So we can say 3L. L squared. Do you say L squared? L cubed is always L. Yeah, okay. So the three L's, LLL, okay? So love, learn, and live, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala. And the question that you addressed to our brother Abdullah Hussain, and you said to him, what does it mean to make the Quran your best friend? I think the best way to understand this question also is to think about how you treat your best friend in real life. You know, when you love someone, how do you treat that person? You're always thinking about that person.
Respect.
Exactly, you respect that person. You speak good about that person. You think about that person. You miss that person. When you're in his absence, you talk about him. When you're in his presence, you talk with him. Okay, so this is the likeness of our friendship with the Quran.
okay, that when we recite it, we should be indulged in it. We should be engulfed in it. We should be loving every single letter and realizing, first of all, it's the kalam of Allah. Second of all, it's got so much meaning. Third of all, it's purifying me. Fourth of all, Allah has given me reward for doing this. Fifth of all, there is nothing I could be doing better if I was to die right now. Yeah? So, we should be engulfed in the Quran. So when I'm with the Quran, I'm loving it. Just like when I'm with my friend, I'm really enjoying my company with him. When I go away from the Quran, I should feel that I miss it. Just like when I go away from my best friend. If you have a good friend, think about a good friend. How you would feel when you're away from, oh man, you know what, man, I know it's a bit weird to say I miss you, but you know, I kind of miss you, innit? Like you probably say that to your friend, innit? But the Quran is even more. You know, there's nothing wrong with missing the Quran. And this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We want to get close to Allah. If we love Allah, we love His Quran. And know this, one of the ways to make the Quran beloved to you, to make your best friend, is to appreciate and to be grateful about the little amount of love you have towards it. Because Allah's rule is, if you're grateful, I'll increase it. If you have a little bit of food, be grateful, Allah will give you more. Okay? If you have a little bit of money, be grateful, Allah will give you more. Okay? If you have a little bit of love for the Quran, be grateful for it, Allah will give you more. If you have a little bit of Quran, be grateful for it, Allah will give you more, inshallah, tabarak wa ta'ala. So think of the Quran as a real friend. Because on the day of judgment, it will become like a real person, either talking for you or against you. Jazakallah khairan.
Barakallah feek. Dear respected brothers, and for anyone who's watching at home, we thank you. Inshallah, you can join us next time for another episode of Friday Dars Extra. May Allah bless you all. May Allah allow us to, you know, act upon everything that we've said. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Middle Path Radio, illuminating the horizon.